Chapter 1, the human body and orientation, part 2. So, when we are comparing the location of two different structures in the body, we first, of course, assume the person is in the anatomical position. Then there are certain terms that we use in anatomy. So, for instance, the first set of terms is superior and inferior. Superior means closer to the top of the head, inferior, closer to the bottom of the feet. So, for instance, here we have the urinary bladder and the esophagus. So, the urinary bladder is inferior to the esophagus. Another set of terms is lateral and medial. In this case, we are referring to the midline, that line that if you cut the body in half through that line, you'd basically get an equal right side and left side. So that's the midline. Medial means closer to the midline. Lateral means further away. So again, in this case, here we have the gallbladder. Here we have the ulna. So the gallbladder is medial compared to the ulna. Again, here's the ulna. Here's the radius. The ulna is medial to the radius. Then we have anterior and posterior. Anterior means toward the front of the body where the chest is, and posterior means toward the back of the body. So front, anterior, back, posterior. So in this case, here is the spinal cord. Here's the heart. So the spinal cord is posterior to the heart. The spinal cord is closer to the back than the heart is. Now, when you're talking about a single limb of the body, an arm or a leg, you use the terms proximal and distal instead of superior and inferior. So you replace superior and inferior with proximal and distal. And these terms are referring to where the limb attaches to the trunk of the body. So proximal is closer to where it attaches to the trunk of the body. Distal is further away. So the humerus here is proximal to the radius. The humerus is closer to where the arm attaches to the trunk than the radius is. And the radius is proximal to the phalanges. We also have the term superficial and deep. This is usually used when layers or structures sort of surround each other. So, for instance, in this case, we have the skin on the surface, the heart inside the body. So the heart is deep to the skin. The heart is further away from the surface than the skin is. And the skin is superficial to the heart. The skin is closer to the surface. It actually makes up the surface than the heart. Planes and sections. So with our amazing technology, we can look inside the body without having to cut it open. But when we do that, the computers will often cut through the body with an imaginary plane, so imaginary sheet going through the body, that is the plane. And then when you look at what's on the surface where that cut occurred, that is the section. So this is the plane, the imaginary structure cutting through the body to give us the section. And the sagittal plane cuts through the body so that you have a right side and a left side. Should the sagittal plane go through the midline, then it's called a mid-sagittal plane because the right side and left side are of approximately equal size. So here is some views of sagittal sections. This one here, this model, is a mid-sagittal section. Then we have the frontal plane. The frontal plane cuts through the body, giving you a front piece and a back piece, or to say it, an anterior piece and posterior piece. And this is what a frontal section would look like going through the body. So here are the lungs, the heart, there's the liver, the stomach. Then we have the transverse plane. The transverse plane cuts through the body, giving you a top part and a bottom part, or you could say a superior piece and an inferior piece. So again, here's a transverse plane. Here is a transverse section going through the abdomen, still allowing us to see part of the liver, some of the intestines, there's the spinal cord. Body cavities. Body cavities are spaces within the body that are filled with stuff. Body cavities tend to be formed by bones and or muscle tissue. Some of the body cavities include the cranial cavity in the skull. Cranial cavities where you find the brain. Then there's the verbal cavity, found within the vertebral column, and that is where we find the spinal cord. We have the thoracic cavity within the chest. Thoracic cavity is separated from the abdominal cavity by a structure called the diaphragm. The sheet-like muscle physically is a separation between the thoracic cavity in the chest and the abdominal cavity. The abdominal cavity has lots of structures in it, the stomach, most of the intestines, the kidneys. And then below or inferior to the abdominal cavity is the pelvic cavity. The border between the two is about where the top of the hips are. There is no physical structure between the abdominal cavity and the pelvic cavity. So they are continuous. And so collectively, they're also known as the abdominal pelvic cavity. And then, of course, in the pelvic cavity, you have the urinary bladder, parts of the intestines, and the uterus and ovaries, if you possess those. The thoracic cavity can also be broken down into four smaller cavities. So a thoracic cavity, as we see here, can be broken down into the right and left pleural cavities. The right and left pleural cavities are where you find the lungs. Pleural cavity defined by a membrane that surrounds the lungs called the pleural membrane. Then we have the pericardial cavity, where we find the heart. That cavity defined by the pericardium, a membrane surrounding the heart. And then we have the mediastinum. Mediastinum is the space between the lungs found in the thoracic cavity. So this means the heart, for instance, is found in the thoracic cavity. It's found in the pericardial cavity, and it is found in the mediastinum. So serous membranes are the category of membranes that the pleural membranes fall under, and the pericardial membrane, and also the peritoneum found in the abdominal cavity. Serous membranes have two layers. They have a visceral layer that lies on the organ, and then a parietal layer that makes contact with whatever is surrounding that organ. And then there's a thin little space between the two layers, and that space is filled with fluid, serous fluid. And serous membranes are very important because they help to protect the organs by reducing the friction they are exposed to as they constantly move, expanding and contracting for the lungs, beating of the heart, and so on. So here is the pleural membranes, right and left, surrounding the lungs, visceral layer lying on the lung, parietal on the outside with that thin little bit of space where you find the serous fluid. We have the pericardium or pericardial membrane surrounding the heart, visceral layer lying on the heart, parietal layer on the outside, and that little bit of serous fluid between those two layers. And then we have the peritoneum. Peritoneum is a very large serous membrane. It goes all throughout the abdominal cavity, surrounds a variety of organs or parts of organs, including liver, parts of the intestine, on the stomach. Again, it has two layers, a visceral layer lying on the organ, parietal layer on the surface, and there is a little bit of fluid between them. So our intestines, our structures within our abdominal cavity are constantly moving. So the peritoneum reduces the friction from all that movement. And an additional function, the peritoneum also attaches structures in the abdominal cavity to each other and to the abdominal wall. So both reduce friction and attach structures to each other and to the abdominal wall. All right, microscopes. Microscopes are very important for looking at cellular and tissue level structures of the body. The light microscope lets you see cells usually and structures and tissues. The samples that you look at must be fixed, which means they are attached to a slide. And they must be stained so that you can see the structures easily. And of course, that means all the samples are dead. So you're looking at thin, thin slices from a body. Transmission electron microscope is much more advanced. It lets you see even closer up. It stains the tissue with metals, and then electrons are actually shot out and allow you to see within the structure. So here again are cells. These are the same cells as seen up here, just now using a transmission electron microscope. And then a scanning electron microscope, again, uses metal or carbon to stain, quote unquote, the surface of the cells. And so it's actually looking at the surface of the structure. So transmission goes into the cells, surface scanning electron microscope just looks at the surface. So again, now we're looking at the top of the cells that we see over here and over here. Pretty cool. Then there are different medical imaging technologies that we now use. This includes radiography. Radiography is using x-rays to expose film. So you shoot x-rays through the body. The x-rays are blocked by dense structures and appear white, so blocked by the heart, blocked by bones. And then where it's not blocked is where the soft structures are, and they appear darker on the x-ray. Here's radiography. This is where we're seeing a three-dimensional structure image on a two-dimensional sheet. Then we have computed tomography. Computed tomography uses a complicated machine that's shooting x-rays in lots of different directions at the structure. The x-rays, our information is then sent to a computer that interprets it and gives us amazingly detailed structures of within the body. You can see them as sections, as shown here, or the computer can even make a 3D model of the part of the body. Here again, transverse section, here's liver, stomach, spleen, vertebral column. Angiography is when we're using x-rays to look at blood vessels. So again, as a CT scan is taken, the blood vessels now become visible because a dense medium, a dye, is injected into the blood vessels, into the bloodstream, and coat the inside of the blood vessels. And this would allow someone to see, say, areas where the blood vessels are narrowing abnormally. That could be a place that needs to be repaired or treated in some way. Sonography uses sound waves. So high-frequency sound waves are sent into a body, say, into the belly of a pregnant woman. The sound waves bounce off structures that are internal, such as the fetus, and allow you to see the surface of those structures. This is very safe. X-rays are damaging to the body. Sound waves are not. So this is used to see fetal development. It can be used to see the surface of organs in the abdominal pelvic cavity or the surface of blood vessels. So there are a variety of uses for sonography. Magnetic resonance imaging is similar to the computed tomography in that there's a big machine that's going to image the body in three dimensions. However, in this case, it's using magnetic fields and radio waves to look internally. And an advantage to magnetic resonance imaging is that, one, it is able to see through bones easier than a CT scan can. And two, it is magnetic field, so it is much safer because it does not use damaging x-rays. That is it for chapter one.